and welcome to Something to Talk About. I'm Linda McNamee, and for the next hour, we are going to learn about self-discovery and how you can be a better you. But before we begin, and you meet my wonderful guest, I would like to invite you to give us a call this evening. You can call us at 781-270-9199. Or if you have a question, suggestion for a future guest, or just sitting at your computer getting bored, you can always email me at talk@bcattv.org. I love to get email that isn't spam, so think about sending me a note, please. And as I always begin, I would like to thank the wonderful volunteers who are helping with the show this evening. We have Colleen Moore, director extraordinaire, and she's probably hating that title by now, but she's an awesome director. We have Maddie Shipka and Jolie Atwood, who are also volunteers giving up their Wednesday evening to help me out and make sure the show runs smoothly and successfully. And we also have staff members, Mike Duval and Corey McNeil, who help run BCAT, making sure that the station stays up pretty much all the time and helps all of us volunteers so we don't crash and burn, because that's not good. And definitely last but not least, I would like to thank my husband, Paul, for staying home for daddy date night. Hopefully the kids are behaving themselves and hope you're feeling better. So I think that's all the administrative duties. So now I would like to introduce my wonderful guest,
Hello.
Jill Patz.
How are you?
Who is, you are like the most amazing person I've ever met. Well, you are a Spartan.
I am a Spartan.
We will get to that in a few minutes. Okay. But I would like to thank you for coming on the show.
Thank you for having me.
And I've heard such wonderful things about your story, and I don't think I've ever heard your story.
Yes.
I've heard bits and pieces everywhere. So let's get into chatting.
Perfect.
So as usual, I ask all my guests kind of where they grew up, you know, and how they kind of came to this area if they're not originally from around here. Mm-hmm. And then we'll get into how you started your journey. So let's back up. Where are you originally from?
I'm from Peabody, Massachusetts.
Okay.
And I lived there till I was about 32 with my mom. She raised me as a single mom. And me and my kids both lived with her for a long time. Mm-hmm. I had both my kids at 17 and 22. So
wow.
I was very young. I was a teenage
That's very
mom.
Young. Wow.
And I had no dad, so I didn't see my dad for a very long time. I met him in 2013 because that was part of my journey.
Oh,
so I did
okay.
go.
So we'll
and,
talk about that.
Yeah, we can talk about that later. So she did raise me and did the best she could. Today I don't talk to her much because I believe you need to get rid of all the poisonous people in your life, even though I love her from afar. So okay. we can get to back to
we'll
that also.
We'll get back to that
yes,
too.
So I lived in Peabody, and I didn't move out of my mom's house till I was 32.
Okay, and now you're living in Burlington.
Now I'm living Woo-hoo! In Burlington. Yes. I've gotten divorced twice. I lived in Peabody.
Okay.
Both those marriages didn't last, and mm-hmm. both of them lived in Peabody. So it was a very small city for
reason
me.
Reason to separate yourself. Well,
yes.
I'm glad you still stayed in this time zone. You
yes.
know, that's helpful. Different area code, same area code.
Different area code.
Different area code.
Yes.
Okay. Well, my next door neighbors are actually in a different area
yep.
code. So, you know, who knows? So, okay, you mentioned a couple of, you know, poisonous or toxic people. What made you decide that you'd had enough and you're like, okay, I need to change my life? Because you hear so many times people just too afraid to make that step. So where did you get the courage and how did you make that first step?
It's a very, very hard decision. I felt as though I was really in hell, as
okay.
I called it. I either had to make a choice, either not be here or improve my life.
Wow.
Because
okay.
it's tough to raise kids on your own.
Oh,
it's the
yeah.
the stress level, working full time, the guilt, the shame, the pressure, just
you know,
everything
financial
gets to financials
too.
Huge. I barely got help, so it was just such a struggle for me, and it was just so hard. It was hard not having a big family. I didn't come from a big family, so not having a lot of family was hard. It was very, very hard.
So you just woke up one morning and said, let's do it? or?
Let's do it. I had to be become a better role model for my kids. Oh, I was not
How
doing
old were
well.
Your kids at the time when you?
My kids, this was 2013, so not too long ago when I woke up.
Okay.
3-4 years ago.
Okay.
Yeah.
So part of your journey, I know, is a significant weight loss, or what I see as significant. So let's see if Colleen can find that shot of you when you first started your journey and, you know, part of, okay, I need to be a better me. There you go.
Yes, there I
go.
So,
wow, you are a lot different now.
Absolutely. I was 187 pounds there.
Wow.
Yeah, but I was sad. I was very sad. And
yeah,
I think
you just, the look on your face, you're smiling.
I'm like,
but
what
you,
is that?
You're like, okay, take the stupid picture.
It's funny because I still see her. When I don't know what I look like, I still see her.
Because when I'm looking at you, I mean, you're glowing. You are just so comfortable with life right now.
I'm very, very comfortable.
And it's only been
I'm very happy.
2.5-3 years.
Yes, I'm very, very happy today.
So, okay. So how did you figure out what aspects of your life needed to change? Obvious, you know, it sounded like mom, but
everything,
you know,
had
your weight
change.
Loss. And okay, so
everything had to change. What I was doing was not working. So but, I had to change mind, body, soul, spirit, everything that I believed in.
That's overwhelming.
It's very overwhelming, and you don't know where to begin. But
And that's kind of what I'm trying to figure out is how did you figure out where to begin?
I wanted to stop my weight loss. That's when I went to Weight Watchers. I walked in the door of Weight Watchers, and I figured out that I had a food obsession. I obsessed over food. I loved to eat. It was my go-to. I was hiding behind everything, eating, and hiding behind my feelings. And food was my number one thing, so I knew I had to tackle that first.
Like the emotional eating.
Because that was my
eating.
Addiction.
Yeah.
It was just as bad as dealing with drugs or anything. It's the same thing, food.
Okay. So once you started that, now did you start everything at once, or did you say, I'm just going to focus on my physical and my health, you know, I need to get myself healthy?
I didn't even go that far.
Okay.
I wanted to tackle just the food aspect and
okay.
stop eating and just get control of eating food. And then slowly as that progressed and I was slowly stop obsessing over food, I started feeling my feelings. And then you start realizing, oh, I have...
Now, did you know that food was like your addiction or your safety net?
I didn't know that at the time.
Okay.
As I was slowly recognizing it, I did recognize that as a problem. Like it was a major, major, major problem.
Okay.
And then slowly as you stop feeling all your feelings and a lot of stuff gets brought up.
Okay.
And meanwhile, all through this, I was going to court with my kids' fathers, trying to fight them for child support.
So this was still going on.
This was still going on,
wow.
Absolutely. My son has not seen his father in 8 years. So it's like, I feel that because I didn't have my dad. So I kind of feel that and take that on, too.
And you also have to explain to your, I'm assuming you have to, like, explain to your son and, you know,
it's
field
very
those
hard.
Questions.
Yeah, it's very hard, too. Like, when they go to sporting events and, you know, they see... other dads playing with their kids, you can see they're heartbroken.
Yeah.
But it's like, how do you
explain it?
Yeah, like, and I've gone through my life always saying, you know, if your own parent don't love you, who's going to?
Yeah.
That I've always had that sentence in my head. So it's like, that's a very hard sentence to follow all the time.
Wow. Oh.
Yeah, so
that's pretty deep.
Yeah, it's very, very deep. And when you think it's just... People don't realize, but like losing, having a parent not around really is a handicap because you always have a void. It's a big deal, you know. Yeah.
Especially, you know, I'm just, you know, jumping to a conclusion here, especially knowing that that parent is still around somewhere.
Absolutely.
I mean, it's, I'm sure it's difficult if the parent had passed on, but knowing that your parent doesn't want to see you or can't see you or
that's,
whatever, I mean,
that's
got to be even... harder, I would think.
That's one of the reasons why we left Peabody, is because my son's father, his new girlfriend, went to school with my son, and they stopped seeing him at the time due to whatever reason.
Okay.
And so, you know, her son was playing baseball with my son, and there was a lot of ignoring going on, and I refused to have my son grow up like that.
Okay.
So I wanted better for them. I wanted to be there for him more. Okay. I work here in Burlington, so I was really excited. So that was awesome. So this was my number one city to go to, so I could always be around.
Excellent. Yeah. So once you figured out that food was your crutch, then how did, you know, you said that your son's dad was one of those toxins.
Yes.
How did you identify and separate yourself from the negative people in your life? Because it sounds like there was more than just one.
I call it delete and block. We delete and block. Okay. And that's, you just got to cut them out. You just got to cut them out. I did get a therapist. I love her to pieces. Okay. I recommend therapy huge to people so they have their person. I love her. She's like, I've been seeing her since then every single week. See her. I don't know what I'd do without seeing her. You know, she was just great. Okay. And she's always understood where I've come from. So people do need somebody to know where they're coming from all the time, you know, without judgment, without. Okay.
Along those lines, you know, without the judgment. Okay, you're removing people from your life. How did you start letting people back into your life and finding those positive influences on you?
The huge place is Weight Watchers.
Okay.
Going to positive places, knowing that there's going to be a positive result. And Weight Watchers was one of them. I mean, you guys are awesome. I know.
It's like, a good group.
We have a great group of girls, and everyone just loves each other. And you really have
couple
to.
Couple guys,
like,
too.
A couple guys, girls, yes, there's a couple guys. You have to put yourself in positive places. And, you know, the number one place, though, is you need to sit with yourself. That's another thing that is huge, is you got to get that uncomfortable of sitting with yourself also and learn to love your own company, because that's huge.
Yeah, you're to with love yourself all the time.
Yes, but I didn't like myself at all.
Oh,
you know,
oh,
so it's not good to not like yourself. But going to I know I went to Overeaters Anonymous for a little while. That wasn't for me. I went there. I went to Al-Anon. I've gone so many. CODA, codependency.
Okay.
You know, just all those places are just all positive, even though they're like not friends.
Okay.
But you still get the support you need. And people that can relate to how you feel.
And even though they're not friends, they're still giving you some positive reinforcement. So that's hey, wait a minute. You know, life can be good.
Absolutely.
So, okay, you mentioned spirituality. And, you know, how did you kind of figure out which pathway to go in there? Because I know at some point you've talked about, you know, meditation tapes and, or not tapes, because we don't have tape anymore.
Yeah.
MP3s or, you know, whatever. How did you figure out which direction to go in there?
That's funny, because I really just do anything that makes me feel well. Sunday I'm going to Joel Osteen's mega church in Texas.
So cool.
I'm doing that Sunday. I go to a Buddha chant on Monday nights. I just do anything that makes me feel. These are Buddha beads. Yeah, you meditate with them and say a chant and count. So. Anything, but meditation is so huge. Like, and that's not even spirituality. It's just being with yourself and getting to the root of you. And
well, that is kind of spiritual. It's not religion,
yes. Okay, it's spirit. Yes, yes. So it's like anybody can do it. It's the best thing ever.
Just that kind of centering yourself and
just going still, just going still and hearing your true self, and quieting the mind. I find that the world is chaotic. And I find that I find that I had to slow down. Okay. So much was expected of me, and I think that was part of my sadness, is that everything was so expected of me, being a mother and keeping up with, you know, the kids in school and their sneakers and everything like that. It was just so overwhelming just to
What the kids now are expected to do in school is also overwhelming.
Absolutely.
You know, my first grader comes home with all this homework and
it's crazy.
The tests that go on and you're like, you know, the kids are stressing out, and I heard, you know, some of the high school kids are stressing out. And are your kids in high school now?
My daughter just graduated. My son's going in tonight.
Okay, so, I mean, you know, the high school stress level, and you have to be that voice of authority and, you know, because your kids feed off of you. So.
They do feed off of me, but I've changed that, because before I was too overbearing and too involved and too...
Helicopter parent.
I was a hover parent. I wanted to be number one. I wanted... now my motto for me is, I want to show them what to do instead of tell them what to do. I think that is so huge in my household. That is how I do it. And I do all the time. I want them to make their own choices. So I struggle with parenting today. Not struggle with it, yes, but I truly believe, like, oh, these kids are so reliant on us and on me, and I feel like they should make their own choices and know what they're doing is.
Well, it's
kind of
hard finding that balance between, you know,
it's
being
very hard.
Giving them their independence, but also being there to kind of make sure that they don't crash and burn. Although
absolutely.
Sometimes they kind of have to crash and burn.
I think you have to crash and burn. I would, if I didn't crash and burn, I wouldn't have got to this place where I'm at. You know, and I know I'm older and stuff, but if they could learn that now, you know what I'm saying, and see that there's light and you can be happy, you know what I'm saying? Because I know they both struggle with things I have.
Okay.
So if I can show them and they take on what I do, you know, and not everything I do works, but it's all individual.
Well, we're all individual,
out.
Yeah.
You know, I do tons of things. I listen to YouTube videos, motivational speaking. I have quotes all the way around, and some people don't prefer that. You know, I constantly have positivity in my life all day long.
Now, backing up a little bit to something that you said like 30 seconds ago, where you hovered over your kids, do you think, you know, subconsciously, or maybe it was a conscious decision, that since your dad was not present in your being raised, that you wanted to be the perfect parent because you didn't have the perfect parents?
Absolutely.
And parenting doesn't come with a manual.
No, absolutely. I did Girl Scouts for 10 years. I ran the Little League concession stand down Peabody 5 years. I wanted to give them everything. I wanted to be the best parent, lack of their fathers. So I wanted to be the number one mom, and I wanted to be invincible. That's my personality, to be 100%. But yeah, I absolutely
and you just
feel
can't.
That.
You can't physically do it.
You can't, or you'll just live with guilt and shame and all that.
Feeling of being a failure.
Absolutely.
Because it's like you hold your standard up this high.
Absolutely.
And, you know, physically. Okay, so moving on to more... another positive aspect that you've changed, along with your weight loss journey, you've also started, you know, we've talked about the meditation. You've also gotten into more physical, you know, the exercise, and you are a Spartan,
which
totally blows me away.
You
just don't wake up one morning and, you know, climb walls and run barefoot through fire pits, you know.
The Spartan's a funny story because I was so scared to do the Spartan race, but it was one of my goals. And when I got to my goal weight in Weight Watchers, I was like, okay, that's what I'm going to do. But I was still scared.
But you had done like 5Ks up to that point.
No, I never did that. I've only walked. I refuse to pay to walk. It's just my thing. I enjoy walking down Wakefield Lake. That's my favorite thing to do. I won't go to the gym at all. I hate the gym. I won't do anything that I can't stand. But the Spartan, I was very scared to do it. And I was going to do it, and then I called this was last year.
Okay.
I called my brother up, and I said, all right, I'm going to do it. And then he goes, all right, I'm going to sign you up. And then the next day I called him back and I go, forget it. I don't want to do it. I'm not ready. And he goes, too late. You're going to do it. I already signed you up.
Now,
and
what
I went,
made you decide
oh,
on a
my
Spartan?
Gosh.
I mean.
He's a Spartan.
Oh, he's a Spartan.
He's legit Spartan. He's the real deal. So, so me and him went, and actually me and my brothers never really had a good.
How many brothers do you have?
Just one.
Oh, just one.
Okay. He's 4 years older. And we've never really had a great relationship. And I felt like we bonded that day. He actually ran the Spartan
race. Oh, he did it with you.
He did it first, and then he did it again to do it with me. And that was really big to me. It really touched my heart because I didn't think he had it in him to be a caring brother. So
It's amazing what, you know, 20 years will do to somebody.
It's unbelievable. So I finished it, and I was all excited, and... it was just unbelievable. So I've done two since.
So you've done three?
I've done three.
Holy let's back up a little bit because it sounds really scary, and I'm sure it is, but what exactly is involved in a Spartan race, and how do you train for it?
I don't train for it.
You don't train for it. Wow.
I don't train for it.
Because I'm like, you know, don't you need like solid core and, you know, climbing? Do you climb walls?
Or you can.
What do you do?
Okay, so you can climb walls. You can climb rope. You can. You go under barbed wire. You swim under mud. You do climb over 10-foot walls, but people help you. It's a Spartan, so everyone's supposed to help you get through it.
Okay.
So it's all about everyone completing. And if you can't help, there'll be a stranger that's just like, here, I'll give you 10 fingers. And that's what's great about it. And that's one thing about the Spartan race that I had a hard time doing was, like, looking for someone to be like, hey, can I help you? Because that's always been my problem, is because I never wanted help.
Okay.
I've never wanted help with my kids, with my anything. I didn't want help. I wanted to do it myself.
So in the race, were you having a hard time offering to help or being helped or both?
At the first race, I didn't feel I could help.
Okay.
Because I
that's
felt like I wasn't small. I was like, these people are like Spartans. I'm not yet. So I felt the first one, the last one I did,
okay,
I got down on my knees and this guy came up and he jumped on my knee and he jumped over it. So it's like, it's, you know,
wow.
I'm wicked excited.
I helped somebody.
Yeah, it was wicked awesome. So I can't wait to, you know, for us to all help each other at the Spartan race with the girls from Weight Watchers. I can't wait till we do that in June.
I can't do that one though.
Yeah. Yeah, me and my boyfriend are going to go in New Jersey at the end of the month. We're going to do the Beast, which is 13 miles.
Wow.
Yeah. Yeah, that's going to be...
Is it like a 13-mile run or a 13-mile Spartan race?
It's a 13-mile Spartan race. It's the Beast.
Holy cow.
So if you...
How do you find out about these?
Spartan.com.
Okay, so it's like its own organization.
Oh, it's like a big thing.
Yeah, do you like stay in contact with... Do you talk to people, you know, other than, you know, helping? Do you talk to them outside the race? Like...
You can. There's Facebook groups. Absolutely Facebook groups. You can share your information. Just if people need a pep talk, people ask them what it's about. There's all the Spartans. It's unbelievable.
Wow. Okay.
Yeah.
And
it's very.
And you haven't done training for it?
No, I just walk.
Okay.
I do just walk. I think cardio is huge.
Climbing walls.
Well, like I said, you can get help. It depends on what you put the pressure on yourself. If you want to do it yourself, you could train. You know.
Okay.
You can also skip that obstacle and you can do 30 burpees. I can do 30 burpees, so I'm okay with it. But it's getting past it. I just want to complete it. So I'm not hard on myself. So I don't go, I'm not in competition with anyone. I'm not in competition with myself. I just want to complete it. And it doesn't matter the time. It doesn't, I just want to complete it.
Okay. Now you just said you're not in competition, but 3 years ago, when you were trying to be the perfect parent, were you competitive there?
No, I was just trying to keep up.
I
was just trying to keep up.
Isn't that still kind of a level of competition?
I guess so. I guess it is.
Was it just kind of a gradual process, or was there a conscious decision for you to say, I don't need to be perfect?
The not being perfect just happened like over the last like 9 months, not having to be perfect. Letting it go, living for the moment, accepting myself for who I am and my flaws. You know, and I guess that's being around people that love me today, you know, and not feeling less than. Being around people less than can really do a job to you.
Okay. Now, you talked about let's not talk about negativity anymore. Let's find out about your trip to Arizona.
Okay.
Because I want to start out with that book that you're carrying.
Okay.
Because when you mentioned that at the meeting, I was like, that is an awesome idea.
Yeah.
So, actually, let's back up a little bit.
Okay.
Why did you go out to Arizona?
Okay. So, one of my things is I was always brought up where we always had a small family. And my mother always used to say, I have no family. And she used to always feel sorry for herself. So I always felt like there was a void.
Okay.
You know, I didn't have a lot of people. And, you know, it was a sad thing to have a small family. It was
you didn't
just
have,
a
like, this huge Italian family my big Greek wedding movie.
Yeah,
you know?
So it's like you just, one thing I was scared about is being alone and just being my friend and liking me and being my own company. I was always uncomfortable with it. So I wanted to go on this trip to be by myself. I wanted to not plan because I was a huge planner before. Okay. So the only thing I had planned on when I went out to this trip was the Spartan race, jumping out of the airplane, and my cup rent a car. Those are the only three things that
what
I
about,
had.
What about like a place to stay? Did you have a place to stay?
No, I didn't have a place to stay. I just, I wanted this to be purely, I was going to be safe and I could make decisions for myself.
Okay.
It was my first trip. My kids stayed home. It was my first trip without them, which was nice.
That must have been hard too, to finally separate yourself from being that, you know, hovering parent to, okay, kids, I'll be back in a week and a half.
Yeah, another thing that I've been tackling over the past year was minimalism and only living with minimal in the necessities to live. So
I don't think I could do that. well, I just have way too much stuff.
For me, I didn't realize how attached to things I was.
Exactly.
So, like, we're attached. Like, it's as a society, I think we're so attached to things.
Like the
I bought a backpack. Did you see the movie Wild?
No, I did not.
The girl that hiked. Well, she had just a hiking backpack. I spent the 7 days. I just packed that backpack, and that's all I brought to the trip.
Wow.
So I wanted to know that I could only live out of that backpack and just carry what I had, and that's how I did it.
Wow.
Yeah. It was interesting.
And you chose Arizona because it was a Spartan race out there.
No. I chose Arizona because that's where I want to land. I love it there. It calls my name. I love the feeling I get out there. It's just like the hot weather, the beauty. Just the serenity is just unbelievable out there.
Okay, so let's talk about the book.
Okay. So this book I had sitting in my yard sale pile because I like to yard sale and I bought it for a quarter. So I looked at the book one day and I walked by it and I was like, what can I do with that book? And I was like, oh my God, I'm going to make a journal out of it. So what I did was took it and I, since so much harm has been done to me that I allowed to happen, I really didn't like people. I wasn't a people person, if you don't.
Okay.
I really didn't.
I have
kept
since
to
learned
myself.
That about you.
I really liked just being alone and
well,
I didn't trust anybody.
Well, if so many people hurt you, I don't blame you for not wanting to get close to anybody because you don't want to get hurt again.
Right. So my next thing was to tackle, and I wanted to learn to have empathy for people, and I wanted to learn that we're all the same. We all want to be happy. There are nice people in the world, and I wanted to prove myself that. So I decided on my journey in Arizona that I would talk to 5 to 7 people a day.
Now, is this just an Arizona book?
Just an Arizona book. Okay. I did start one for here, but I'll get into that.
Oh, we'll talk about that later.
Yep. So this is my book, and I decided that I wanted to share my story with people, and I wanted to share my story with people, and I wanted to hear what their story is. So I'd walk up to people in Arizona and just have at coffee or lunch and be like, hey, can I have coffee with you? And just that alone is uncomfortable because people
that's
think you're crazy. But out there, they were so welcoming, and people were just like, yeah, okay. And as I was just talking.
Might have been awkward for them, too. It's like, okay,
absolutely.
Why is this person coming up? What do they want?
Yeah. A few of the people.
Maybe that's a New England thing. I don't know.
Yes. a few people told me what their passions was. That's my one thing is I'm looking for my passion. I've been working for the phone company, which went on strike today, for 20 years, and it's not my passion. It served its purpose. It helped me raise my kids. And now I want to do something that I really, really love. So I want to go around, and I've been asking people what their passions are, if they are pursuing their passions, if their career is their passion, because I truly, truly believe you have to love what you do.
I learned that the hard way.
Yes, I think many years and many days I've gone to work and I'm like, this isn't making me happy.
Yeah.
So I do think happiness is huge.
Absolutely.
And I do. It's just so amazing that I find that today and I'm looking for it. So in the book, so I shared my journey, asked them what their life was about, and they would write me a little message.
Oh,
and I
cool.
take a selfie with each and every one of them.
Selfie.
So I have.
We need to get you a selfie stick.
I have one.
Oh, you have one. Of course you have one.
Yes, I have one. So I have pages and pages and pages of.
Now, there are like some other things other than pictures, like the little drink stick.
Yeah.
And there was a, you know, tickets and a pencil. And
yeah.
How did you decide or determine what to put in there? Is it just like where you met the people? Like if it wasn't at a coffee shop, if it was, you know, metro at the metro station or.
everything I did in here was on instinct. So if wow. I felt like I should put it in the book, I put it in the book. Like the metro, I never took a train before. Like I never took a transit bus before in my life. So I figured out the system out there. So I was wicked excited about that. But cool. like this guy's socks here. Like before I would have never took the time and calm my thoughts enough to see that.
To notice.
So it's like, we don't realize how crazy like our minds are.
Pastel Argyle socks.
That's what I'm saying. That's awesome. Okay. So I was just like, so like to be able to slow your mind down and be able to see things now is very big, very big for me. Okay. So my book is just endless amounts of.
Is that a slipper in there?
It's a sock. Yes. A sock. Some girl gave me a sock. She wanted to write her message on a sock.
Okay.
Yeah. So she wrote a message on a sock. Yeah. So then I have so many messages, wonderful, wonderful messages. I sat with a homeless man on the side. I went in because I promised myself I don't charge anymore. Charge cards are bad for me, so I don't charge anymore. Okay. It's just a bad thing. So I would eat at the grocery store. So I'd go in, get my yogurt, and then I saw this guy at the side of the grocery store, and I wanted to know his story because it's almost like I learned to like not recognize them for being there. We're just supposed to turn our backs, or you know, they're dangerous or whatever the deal is. So I bought him an orange and a banana, and I sat right on the sidewalk with him, and I said, "I want to know your story. What's up? How's your day?" Wow. And so he told me a story, and his story was unbelievable. And his wife passed away, and he left Mississippi because he couldn't take it, and he felt bad being there. And that could be any one of us.
Yeah.
So like that was he was my favorite guy and my favorite like emotional time that I had there.
Wow.
Yeah, I really.
Now, did anybody ever say, no, I don't want to talk to you?
No one. No one out there did. Not one person.
That's impressive.
It was unbelievable.
And you met your goal of five new people a day?
I have more than five a day. I'm like, I definitely have more than five a day.
Did you start at like five and then a couple days later say, hey, this is getting kind of easier? And, you know, just the as you did it, it was positive reinforcement because everybody was saying yes. And then it's like, hey, I can do this.
Yeah.
I can do this. And it just kind of, you know, snowballed or. Yeah.
I stopped doing the numbers. I just, I would talk to whoever I thought I wanted to. Or, or if like we met eye contact, I'd be like, how are you today? And, and it's amazing how you can look at someone and say, how was your day today? And they put a smile on their face. Like, it's just amazing, like how, oh my goodness, just a hi could make someone's day because they might have not have talked to someone all day long.
So you
could make someone's day. Absolutely.
And
just saying, how was your day today, could change someone's life.
And then listening.
Yeah. It's amazing.
I think the important part is listening.
Absolutely. And that's one thing about like that I like to share my story with people is because I was completely in the dumps. And for me to like take this trip all by myself and see that all these people like me and where I am today, it's just such an awesome, awesome time and an awesome experience to share.
Now, do you ever, stream of consciousness here. Mm-hmm. Did you ever kind of daydream what would happen if the you now talked to the you from then? Like what happens if you were that person, and somebody walked up to you and said, "How was your day?" Did you ever like daydream how your life might have changed?
I never did that.
I'm just sitting here thinking about this, going, "Gee, I wonder what would have happened if somebody came up to me on the other end."
But I guess people do that to me now. You know what I'm saying? And they still
I don't know.
No, I get it. I totally get it. Like
maybe I'm getting a little too philosophical now.
It's really like, and it's what's great is like a bunch of the people were like this guy here. He was like, "Okay, I'm gonna do this. I'm gonna sit down and have coffee with somebody.
I'm gonna get a book."
And I'm like, it's great. You know, it's just great to be able to just take the time out and just get to know somebody. And you know, it was very, very inspirational.
Wow.
I did several millions of things out there.
Yeah,
I couldn't
looks
even
like it.
I just went, I stayed at the Wigwam Hotel. I slept in my car.
Wait, isn't the Wigwam Hotel like
Route 66?
Somebody told me that Cars,
yes,
the Cozy Cone was modeled after the Wigwam, yeah, Hotel.
Yeah, it's right here. Yeah.
They were like actually teepees that you slept in it.
Yeah.
Cool.
Slept in it, yep. I slept in my
so car
one night.
Carwin? Wow.
Yeah. On the Zion.
Okay.
The Zion State Forest.
Okay.
I hiked up the Angel's Landing, which I realized that people aren't supposed to do that alone.
Whoops.
But I don't have an I'm supposed to in me, so I do whatever I feel like it.
Do what you want, ask questions later.
Absolutely, yes. Okay. I went on the road that Forrest Gump stopped running on. That was
Did
very,
you run?
Very cool. I didn't run because it was a busy street. There was okay, cars, but yeah. I did enjoy seeing
Ron
that.
Ron Forrest, like, you're driving awesome. Down the car, you know, with the window open going, Ron Forrest,
so
Ron!
Funny.
yeah.
It was so fun. I stayed in youth hostels, which was very, very interesting because I've always thought you had to stay in hotels.
Okay.
Yeah, I stayed in bunk beds with six people in it. Met all sorts of kids. I went to a basketball game with a 22-year-old boy because he was just going. And I was like, do you want company? And he was like, yeah. And I said, all right, can I go? He's like, be ready in 3 minutes. And I said, I'm coming.
Okay.
So I went.
Okay.
Yeah, I just have stories after stories. Like, it's just unbelievable.
Now, were you ever scared at any point?
Never.
Because I'm thinking, you know, a single woman traveling by herself, you know, 3,000 miles away from home.
Yeah. I don't get scared. I'm ready to face all fears, all my fears, because I don't want to go through life with fears, ever. I remember a few people kept on saying, be careful, because I post on Facebook all the time, and people would say, mm-hmm. be careful. So I put a post on the very first day I was there, and I was like, listen, have faith in me, because I wouldn't put myself in harm danger. Please don't tell me to be careful. Because I feel like that's a negative thing, because
I don't
listen to anybody. You know what I'm saying? I really, truly don't listen.
Somebody
listen
says, be careful.
Jill.
It's a challenge.
My thing about it is I live here in Burlington, and no one says how, you know,
nobody tells me to be careful.
Something could happen to me at my house. And,
yeah.
You know, this is actually easier because no one knows where I am bouncing around the state of Arizona. You know what I'm saying? Someone could break into my house. You don't know.
Yeah.
So it's like, I just didn't want to be questioned, and I just wanted people to have faith in me. And I was like, so I posted that, and I was hoping that they didn't take offense to it, because it wasn't anything to be offensive. I wanted to really
this
trip was just solely
this.
Knowing that I can do this.
Yes.
And I can face the world alone. And not that I want to be face the world alone, but I wanted to know that I could do this. You know, since I live with my mother, it's 21, you know, 31. And like, it's time to face the world, you know, to know that I am capable, and I am, you know.
Now, along with the trip, you know, I know you had sent me a couple of pictures of you on your trip.
Yeah.
A couple of pictures at Grand Canyon.
Mm-hmm.
So when you went to the Grand Canyon, did you hike it? Did you just walk around? Did you go down into it? Colleen, I don't know if you can find one of those pictures for us. Oh, selfie. Is that the Grand Canyon?
No, that was Sedona.
Sedona.
Yeah,
oh,
that was Sedona. Very, very beautiful.
I was thinking it kind
those
of looks
the red
like
rocks.
Zion. Oh, okay.
Rocks.
Excellent.
That was the Grand
that's
Canyon.
That's the Grand Canyon. Yep. Now, that's obviously not a selfie. Did
no,
you?
No, someone that, took a picture of me there because I wanted
from your
that
book?
Picture. Yes, someone from
okay.
the book.
I'll take your picture if you take my picture.
Yeah.
Oh, that's beautiful.
Yeah, it was so beautiful. And I just love that picture. So right before I went, I watched the movie, one of the movies that was out.
Okay.
And the very last scene in the movie was the girl standing there. And I said, I want to do that. So I knew I was going.
So you're
so
not
going to
run down the Forrest Gump Road, but you'll get your picture
taken. I didn't
go
in the Grand Canyon, but I did go. That was a ledge. I'm like, that was a ledge.
Well,
and I did stand there, and I asked someone to take my picture.
Now, isn't there some area of the Grand Canyon that has, like, the glass walkway?
Yeah, that was closed.
Did you? Oh, it was closed.
It was closed because that's the upper rim.
I don't know.
I was at the bottom.
I haven't been to, you know, it's been almost 40 years since I went to the Grand Canyon, and I don't remember much.
And then I was tired because I did the whole Angel's Landing before that. So the Angel's Landing was about almost like a 5 to 6 hour hike.
Oh, wow.
So then I drove, and I drove to the Grand Canyon, then I stayed at the hostel in Flagstaff. So I was, it was a long day.
Yeah, okay.
It was a very, very long day. Yeah.
I completely lost my train of thought. Okay. So, skydiving.
Yes.
You went skydiving.
Yep, I got a whole page of it.
What made you, what happened to that sock
in your book? When I jumped out of the plane.
Yeah.
Well, when I was thrown out the plane with the guy, my foot scraped against the side and my shoe was hanging half off. So this, I saved the sock and put it in here, and that was it.
Wow. Yeah. Okay.
Yep. I think one of my funny pictures is on there.
Yep. Colleen, can you find the skydiving picture? I think I also wore a red suit when I went skydiving. I love that face. It's like, okay. And how come?
Look at his smile. Like, see?
Oh, yeah.
The smile.
You're like, let me out of here. But actually, I went skydiving too. And yeah, I think I have a picture very similar to that, except for, you know, I strapped a man named Bubba to my back. And I'm like, okay.
So funny.
And it's funny, you know, because when we were, you know, when I went skydiving, we're in the perfectly good airplane, except for it didn't have a door. It just had this curtain. I don't know if yours had a real door or not. But, you know, we're climbing in altitude and, you know, striking up a little conversation with a man named Bubba. And he says, what made you want to go skydiving? And I'm going to ask you this question afterwards so you can start thinking about your answer now. He says, so what made you want to go skydiving? And I said, well, when I turned 29, I hated it. I had a crisis. I hated my job. I hated where I lived. I hated my lack of social life. I was just completely miserable.
Yeah.
And I figured, okay, turning 30, you know, and I went to a party when I was 29. Well, I went to parties a couple more times than that. But this one party that I went to, another woman that was there had just gone skydiving. She said, it was amazing. And I said, that's it. I'm going to go skydiving for my 30th birthday next year. I have a year to talk myself out of it. But I'm going to jump into the next decade of my life. And hopefully it will be better than that one. So, you know, I'm telling Bubba this. His real name was David, but everybody told me his name was Bubba. Yeah. So, you know, we're cruising up there, and I told him, I said, what made you want to become a skydiving instructor?
Oh.
I said, what made you do this? I said, well, apparently I went out with friends one night, and we had a little too much to drink, and the next thing I know, I'm jumping out of an airplane.
Oh.
So he was basically made a bet with someone when he was intoxicated and
good.
Had such a good time when he was sober and jumped out of a perfectly good airplane that he's now an instructor and he jumps like 15 to 20 times a day. But his real job is a psychologist.
Wow.
And I'm like, okay, that's got to have like some deeper
absolutely
meaning. Psychiatrist or psychologist, I don't know, but I'm just like, okay. And you jump out of airplanes for a living. Fun.
Yeah.
So, what made you decide to jump out of a perfectly good airplane with a man named Bubba strapped to your back? Oh, no, that wasn't Bubba.
I don't even know his name. It's not even here. In the video that I had, I said bucket list check.
Oh. Okay.
My reasoning is that I said I'd never jump out of an airplane. And so I was facing that fear.
Okay.
So I was facing the fear, and that was really scary.
See, I wasn't scared. I think the only time I was scared was when I swung my legs over, dangling out of the airplane at, you know, whatever it was, 3,000 feet. But then as soon as we went ready, set, go, it was like silence. And all you heard was the wind. And you had no sense of falling because there's no point of reference.
Right.
You're just there.
Oh, you could hear me swearing my head off.
Oh, you were? You swore? Okay. I was like,
I was swearing. Really cool. I was screaming. I was like, oh my God. I'm like, yeah.
So would you do it again?
I would go again. I say I wouldn't, but I would. I would.
I think I would.
Well, I would like to do it with somebody. Yeah. Because it was like, I think like looking around and being like not to look at someone and go, are you ready? You know, and that comfortableness and just being like, all right, it was the same as in the Zion. Like then when I slept in my car, I was just like, okay, I'm alone. Like if I go missing, like nobody's even knows where I am. It's the same as like skydiving. Like there's no one to just look and say, hey, you ready? Or, you know, and so it's very hard to look at yourself again, but you get through it.
You get through it. Yeah. Wow. So what else is, you mentioned, you know, skydiving was on your bucket list. What else is on your bucket list? That's G-rated. No, kidding. I got several. I'm kidding.
My next goal, and I just signed up, is at Bay Path. I signed up a couple weeks ago. I'm starting school Tuesday there. I do go to Middlesex right now, okay. But I like there. They're very intimate there, and I like that it's an all-women's college. I'm going to go for counseling. So I'd like to be a counselor, yeah. I really, really would like to help people.
Now, how long do you anticipate it to take you to achieve this next goal?
Probably
like skydiving
2 years.
Is like 5 minutes. But
yes. Probably 2 years. I'm going to say 2 years.
Are you working for an associate's?
Just
an
associate's.
Okay.
No, it is a bachelor's.
It's bachelor's.
I'm working on my associate's now at Middlesex.
Oh,
but I was just going to do liberal studies, and I had only 13 credits left.
Okay.
And I said, that's really not what I really want to do. I don't want to sit behind a desk anymore. I really, truly want to help people that want to help themselves. That's the key.
That's
I'm
the
like,
key.
You know, because I don't want to be forced to help someone that doesn't want to really help people.
Well, you also can't really help someone who doesn't want to. You can't change someone who doesn't want to change.
Exactly. Well, that's, I was going to go
Human resources?
Human services.
Human services.
Helping people that might not want to be helped. And I think that you got to want to be happy.
Okay.
You know, to be happy.
So excellent. Yeah. So how are your kids handling the new you?
Oh, that's a good question.
Or do you not want to talk about that?
No, we can talk about that.
Okay.
Absolutely.
Because, I mean, it sounds like, it's like night and day.
It's very
hard. In the past 3 years.
Oh, my God, yes.
You know,
my daughter
used to the hovering mom.
And they're probably watching this, so it's going to be funny. my daughter, she is 20, and she thinks I'm a riot. Like, we are funny. She appreciates it.
Would she travel to Arizona with you the next time?
No.
Okay. I wasn't sure.
She's not adventurous. She's fine being home with the cats.
Okay. Well, somebody's got a cat sit.
My son, on the other hand, is a dancer. And I was a dance mom for many years.
Hip-hop
dance, he does hip-hop, tap, salsa. And he was on the Little Funk team that danced for the Celtics, so he does do it professionally.
Cool.
And me and him struggle a little bit because he was dancing 6-7 days a week. And
you were always there.
I was always dance mom going like this. Like, and I love him to pieces, but it's like that before was my passion. It was my purpose. Seeing them succeed was my happiness.
Okay.
I realize now I got to have my own hobbies, my own loves, my own, you know what I'm saying? So he struggles with it since I'm his only person.
Yeah.
You know, I think he struggles with that.
Because
me and him were buddies. And we still are, but we bump heads. Plus he's 15. So that's it. And then the whole thing about, like, before I would just spend any amount of money on anything.
Okay.
You know, so I think me not spending my money
like
on Jordans and this, that, the other thing.
Well, you're also saying that you're more minimalistic.
Yes.
If that's a word.
Yes, minimalistic. Yes. So, but I won't go charge, just be like, oh, we're bored. Let's go to the mall and buy sneakers. Or, you know, so I've changed that whole aspect of my life.
I'm having a hard time doing that. You know, it's like, oh, it's a quiet Saturday afternoon. Let's go shopping.
I'll be like, let's go walking around the lake, you know, because that's so much better. Hiking. Or, I just find so much more enjoyment not spending any money. So, me and him butt heads about that and think they want. And I find it very stressful. You know, today I can entertain myself on nothing.
Wow.
So it's, on just being quiet and meditating. And
readable.
I really like quiet now.
Oh, okay.
So
I am yelling at you. I'm sorry.
Oh, you can yell. That's fine. I get excited too. But, I think I have a hard time with just driving around because I feel like a lot of having a teenager is you're giving money and driving around. So it's kind of like,
that's just having kids in general.
Yeah, but I don't like that. I'm like, I want there's got to be something in it for me too.
Yeah.
I mean, we can't just drive and sit in the car. So, you know, I think that happened with, I think maybe people might judge me a little on that, but I really don't care. You know, sometimes I'll be like, oh, okay. You know, I know I should want to drive him to dance and stuff like that, but I just don't want to sit in the car for 3-4 hours anymore.
That's understandable.
You know what I'm saying? So it's like,
I will still be your mom. I will still
struggle,
support you.
You know,
but, you know, I need
I've been called selfish a few times, and I'm okay with it because I put a lot of time and I've gave them a lot of years, and it's time for me to give to myself because if I'm happy, you know, everybody's happy.
And you're also, you know, the way you we had talked about earlier, it's like you're not being that hovering, you know, stage mom anymore. You are letting them be their own individuals.
Absolutely.
And you are letting them grow and develop into being their own.
Yes.
Their own people, their own beings.
Yes, I think I did learn that from my mother, because my mother hovered. She worked for the phone company. I worked for the phone company. She had short hair. I have short hair. You know, I had a Kia Soul. She got a Kia Soul. I'm like, it's like, stop it. So it's like, I really
And you both got little hamsters to teach how to drive your Kia Souls.
But I think, like, I'm the opposite, and I did not like that.
Okay.
Oh, my God, that was so... like,
because this
oh my
is
God,
what's
I felt
expected.
Like I had
Mom
a bag over
it.
My head. Yeah, so now I think now I'm so like opposite, and okay. I'm like, do what you want, because I don't want them not to talk to me.
Yeah.
I want my kids always to talk to me.
Right.
So I don't think any of us know the answer. I really don't, but I know this is the answer for me right now.
Yeah.
And I feel like everyone's got to find their true happiness. You know, I even told him, because I know sometimes he still struggles with the whole dad thing, and I just said, you know, instead of searching for it, you really truly have to find your true happiness, something that can fill that void, running, eating healthy, on that level. Instead of, you can't replace things with people. You really can't. Today I live with no expectations, love no expectations. Like, because if you don't expect anything from me and I don't expect anything from you, we just have a good time, you know?
That's true.
You know?
That's true.
But if I came here and expecting to be like, oh, entertain me, what do we do, you know? And you didn't live up to my, we all always get disappointed. So if you enter anything with no expectations, you can just enjoy what is given to you.
That's interesting. Kind of like that theory.
Yeah, it really works.
So if, you know, if life were a video and you were to rewind 3 years back to the beginning, would you... I don't know if, you know, would you do anything differently?
No.
Or, you know, is this how you would have seen yourself back then?
I would have never guessed this is where I was going to be. I would have never in my life guessed that today this is where I'd be, ever, ever. I think it's a miracle that I am where I'm at. From where I came from, there was a lot of hurt and a lot of pain, and I still cry. I still like,
well,
but I'm cry of happiness. Like, it's so happy that, like, you know, I still love both their fathers. Like, I can say today, I thank them. You know, for you know, they were both on drugs, heavy drugs, and I thank them for making me stronger. Like, they're part of my journey, and I would none of it I would give up. None of it. None of it.
Now, what advice, do you have advice that you would give someone who was you from 3 years ago? You know, what would you have said to yourself 4 years ago? You know, how do you start that journey? Is there...
Oh, God. You got to want it. You really, really got to want it. You got to want change. You got to want to be happy. And you got to want to do everything in your power to change everything.
You did a lot on your own, and I keep thinking of, like, all of these stories that you hear about women in horrible relationships, and they're afraid, you know, they're afraid because they don't think they have a support system, but there is a support. Did you, you know, where should you look for a support system? Do you know? Did you find one?
I reached out everywhere. I went to Hawk for, oh my goodness, I went to Hawk for 10 years, help for abused women and their children. That was that. I've always been a seeker for therapeutic groups, people that thought like me. And I was never scared to admit that I wanted help.
Okay.
So I always reached out. I never went to my family or friends, though, for, like, I'd vent and stuff like that. But, like, for real deep, like, wanting to get help, I always reached out, because there's a support group for everything out there, everything. There is a support group for everything.
Start looking.
You just start, like, looking. Okay. And like I said, I do a lot of motivation videos just on YouTube. For a little while, Oprah, Deepak, and Joel Osteen were my three
there
friends at one time.
They're
you know what I'm saying?
Friends.
And I was just like, okay, they're on the news, but they're on TV.
Yeah.
But you get to know these people.
They say something that just strikes a chord with you.
Absolutely.
Absolutely.
Yeah, I would just reach out, talk. Even if you have family and friends, sometimes you just, to a shame, talk. Just in the Weight Watchers, I talk. You know what I'm saying? You got to talk. And
you form friendships with people that you, you know, would never envision.
Absolutely.
Like, you now have a very good friend that you met that you said, if you walked up to her on the street.
Oh, my God, Kim, yes. She's going
to laugh. I wasn't going to say her
Kim,
name.
I'll say your name, Kim. She's at-home mother. She is a nurse, but, she's just different. I'm so opposite than her. On the school ground, I've been like, what a snob. and she knows that I say, and she'd look at me like, what a nut, you know? We would look at the same, but it's like through Weight Watchers and sharing our feelings, we've grown to be such special friends.
Has that helped you, because earlier in our conversation, you said you wanted to learn empathy. Meeting her, was that a way that you could realize that we're all the same here?
Through my journey, she was probably the first person that accepted me for me and opened my eyes that someone might like me as a person, because I was so beaten inside and felt so bad about myself.
Wow.
That, she really, I said, she likes me for some reason. So she opened my eyes to that.
It's like, okay, why are you being so nice to me?
Yes. Yeah, it was very, very... She's very special to me.
Now, has this, just thinking about, has this journey helped you with trust issues or learn how to trust people better?
Yeah, I guess I could work on that a little bit more. But, I'm okay with just relying on myself. I don't require a lot. So, I only deal with people in my life today that I get a good vibe from. I do everything on vibe. And if I feel they're
a good...
Well,
like your book, it's like I'm not sure I would know how to approach people.
Yeah, it's the icon. I think once you open your eyes and you're like, ooh, okay, hey, oh, you want to talk to me? Hey, how are you? And there's just this connection. There's
kind of like walking through the mall. Don't look at them.
It's almost like when you
they're going to ask me for skincare products.
Yeah, it's like when you open up your heart and your eyes, connections and there's energies in the world. It's very enlightening. It's very, very enlightening. And since then, I've gone, I don't eat meat anymore. I don't, I don't do dairy.
I just had pepperoni pizza for dinner tonight.
Yeah.
Okay, there goes.
I'm starting to realize I really want to like my body. I really want to love myself and really know what I'm putting in my body is healthy. Because this is your home. This is my home.
You don't get a new one of these.
Yeah, you don't get a new one. Once you damage it, it's done. So it's just like there's so much just bad stuff in the world.
Wow.
So it's like we really got to, I have to for myself and just love myself and wherever I end up or wherever my journey takes me to, knowing that this home is healthy and happy, that's all that really matters. Because if you're healthy and happy, you can be healthy and happy anywhere you land or you can meet anybody, you can do anything.
And you know what? We're out of time!
We're out of time.
And that was the perfect ending.
Awesome. Perfect.
Well, thank you so much. I finally got to hear the story.
Yes, thank you very much.
And I love sharing your book.
Awesome.
And
thank you.
The skydiving stories and everything.
Yep.
So thank you very much.
Thank you.
And I want to thank everyone at home for tuning in this evening. I hope you found Jill's story as enlightening and inspirational as I have. And I hope you have a wonderful week. And I will see you around town. Good night.